dobrý večer. I didn't knew that I will speak here in this place, and particularly I am surprised to see so much young people. I am really very grateful. Also, you see, I look a little bit when I see you, casual and sporty dress, I look like somebody who goes to a gala concert. But indeed, you see, I come from a gala concert. I was yesterday night in St. Petersburg, and I hear the Mariinsky Orchestra and also wonderful soloists. So the impression I am getting is that Russia is an enormous musical country. And if I look back and think what the music in the 20th century has been, I mean, you cannot go around of Prokofiev, Shostakovich, Rachmaninoff, and the Rite of the Spring of Stravinsky, you know, very much related to this moment of the year, isn't it? And by the way, composed in, partially composed in Switzerland, where I have been living so long time. So it is, I wanted to call my talk. They asked me, I have to give a name to the talk, and I immediately came to my mind the idea of calling it To Russia with Love. And it is, because effectively I have a relation to the country who comes from far away, and it came to my mind the first time I came to Moscow. It was more than 20 years ago. I has had an exhibition here, and by presenting the exhibition, we has had the models just put on top of the boxes in a beautiful palace here in the city. And a lady came to me and tell me, I understood it through the translator, of course, you has had a beautiful, a lucky childhood. And it's true, it's true. It came also to my mind, my brother Joseph, who gave me, when I was maybe 12 years, a book of Boris Pasternak, the Dr. Zhivago. In the meantime, I learned about other authors, and particularly Joseph Brodsky, where I read La Fondamenta dei Incurabili, Italian, or Erinnerungen and St. Petersburg, or the Elegies of Byzance. And so it's effectively, I mean, I think the fact also that 3 summers ago, counting already this summer, I was honored with an exhibition in the Hermitage of St. Petersburg, it will not be worth, you know, to spread my gratitude. And what I'm trying to do in this conference, in this talk, is more a bit to present a series of projects through a series of images. But I want to excite you, young people, you see, about something, you know. It is, at the one side, that it's very simple, that architecture is an art, like painting, sculpting, music, or theater. And the second, that you have has a tradition of enormous architects, like, for example, they asked me when I was here 20 years ago, what do you want to see? Of course, I want to visit the Kremlin and those things, but I say I want to see a work of Melnikov. And they brought me in his house, where I met the son of Melnikov, who was, or maybe he's still a great painter. So, it is important that we understand that in the spirit of all those people, you see, they brought the sense that architecture is an art, isn't it? An art of our time. And also that they practice very much with the art of drawing, which through the computer is getting a little bit lost, isn't it? But who is very important because it's the most direct vehicle between your mind and the paper and get enriched with the value of the gesture. So let's start now. Well, you can, excuse me. Well, go ahead, please. The doctor, you put something. No, just, go put it here. Thank you. Yes, you see, this is a sculpture. It's a sculpture done for a museum, and it has nothing else than the idea of the waves, of the sea. You see, of the waves, yes. The waves of the sea, you see, maybe even the idea of mountains, hills, soft hills. So it's this very simple idea. You see, I want also to put a bit of color. Just this kind of expression, nothing else. Go ahead. It is located in the Melos Museum in Dallas. It's built in bronze. And it has been the key element who brought me to the following building. Can you go ahead? You see, this is in a Spanish landscape in the region of La Rioja, Alavesa, and I has had to do an industrial building in the reality, which it is just a winery in which people elaborate wine. But I was so fascinated with the landscape and through the idea of the mountains behind, and then the running hills around, so that I thought that the prototype, let's call it like that, the idea of the sculpture could be translated into this building here. See, he also, in a way, however, I tried to, not to mimic, you know, but to react to the landscape and to the topography, even to the movement of the mountain, you know, toward us, you see, in the background. Also to the color of the place, the gray of the roof, the brown of the earth, the beige brown of the earth, and the walls and the aluminum, and also the rocks in the background. So it's important, I think, in a way, you see, not only that the building functions, and this, I said before, is almost an industrial building. The graves enter on one side, and the others come out on the other side with good wine. So here also, you see the, you see also the rocks in the back who are advancing, and also even the building in the center, you know, has a movement toward us. These are some details. In the reality, the building is not as big as made appears. The door is barely 2 meters, 40, something like that. But working the scale of the elements gives the sense of a certain, let's say, working with the scale in the element itself gives a certain sense of monumentality. This is the entrance itself. These are some of the spaces in with the place where the bottles are. This is also looking from the back, also in a way, you know, very modest. This is just concrete, a little bit of wood and aluminum. And here is some views in the day and the night. Here is another example. It's a little bit different. There was a time in which I was much more in the early phase of being an architect. You read things, and one of the beautiful parts that you have in it is that you feel the possibility to confront your work and admire the work of the, even the Asian masters. I read once about Michelangelo in a book of Matteo Marangoni, who says, quotating Michelangelo, l'architettura dipende dalle membra dell'uomo. I mean, the architecture depends on the human body and the human members. I think what we start this so I started a bit thinking for myself and making this kind of reflection. You see, for example, you see a face. And the idea of the eye. Composition done with brass, in which the bead, you see, he moves. It moves on the stone if you push it with a hand. So, introducing even the sense of the movement of the eye is also moving and is introspecting into the wall. But it's a personal way. This is the beauty of this, in my opinion, is because it exalts your freedom to interpret things in a way and translate them into artifacts, who means things who are done for the art, artifact. And in a way, you see, here there is something of that. You see, there is something of that in this building. It's a new concrete building dedicated to the music. It was also something to, is necessary to say, this was the less, yes, you see, we are close to the sea, but once was the less desirable place in Tenerife. It was an industrial, reminiscent of the industrial raffinery, oil raffinery in the island, and there was also the place where they used every generation to cover the waste. But you see, working with the city, we transformed part of the raffinery in a convention center, and the mountain with waste was covered with palms, and is today a palmetum, and it is a park, and sanitated. And we construct also close to these two areas, this building you are seeing, landmarking the place. Today is one of the most desirable, you know, in a period of 15 years, became one of the most desirable places to live in Tenerife. You see here is a whole building has been built in concrete. You see here also this is exposed concrete on one side, and here the terrace is very open, the climate is very convenient. You see they have almost a spring all the time. And even if you can see the corridors inside are just protecting from the wind, even there are no windows. We are looking at the sea directly. And this is the rehearsal area, and the one of the lobbies. There are two lobbies, an upper lobby and a lower lobby, and this is the sound with a kind of cones going up over 40 meters, and then you can see the daylight. This is a view with Again, now you see, I'm working on the line down. Through a building or through architectural intervention, you can regenerate an area. You can create better places to live. Not only do you have the freedom to do them in a way that you can project yourself as a person or an artist, or like that, but also you are doing something, in my opinion, fundamental for the community, restructuring and recovering places who have been degenerated through previous intervention, and even highlight and bring them into a level that they became very desirable places. Again, I was before speaking about the sentence of Michelangelo, and you see the human body has been a source of inspiration, not only for me, but for many other people. And finally, emphasize also the fact that the architecture is there for persons, isn't it? Architecture is done for human beings. And it is also logic that in a way, the measures of the human being and their bodies influence in terms of proportion and in terms of rhythm and dimensions, and also you see, it is also very important is the idea of the movement, not only the static idea, but the idea of the dynamic component, who, in my opinion, is an enormous modern aspect of our time. Let's paint them in blue. When my children were very small, I wondered about how difficult it is to stand. As I understand it, it's something that we have had to learn, isn't it? And it takes a while until a child can finally stand up. So I thought that's something mysterious in all that. And I started making a series of plastics about the essence of standing by taking, as you can see here, cues, and putting them one over the other, and with a minimal, absolutely minimal number of elements, make them stand. And not only stand, but also do, as I am doing, twist around the axis, which is also a wonder. And I arrived to these forms. So, as I say, very minimal and very precise, and just, you see, related, you see, to a mechanical, at the time I was also coming out of my studies as a civil engineer, so I was very much impressed about all what has to do with the static and degrees of freedom and all of that. Even it was, the mechanisms was for me very important. out of that here came directly, you know, this building that you are seeing is called People Call Returning also. In reality, the story is another. There was two buildings. One was a straight with a cube, the straight one over the other. It has had one cube more. And then the other one was this here, and I wanted to call one Romeo and the other Julia. But can you call me Julia? Which is probably the other part. Yeah. And you see here the building. It's a building that has been built also for rent, with a social mixed apartment, and was developed from probably the eldest developer in Europe called HSB, who has had at the time 125 years of subsistence. So it originally was a cooperative. And then the apartments here, they are from low rent, middle rent, into the last one, high rent. That's also another aspect, you see, from my work. I was asked before about public transportation and movement of people and infrastructural works, and what is my opinion about traffic. And I never drive a car. In all my life, I never drive a car. I renounced to get a driving permit. But I love cars. You see, I think cars are wonderful artifacts, and I love trains. And I use taxis, airplanes, buses, bicycles, whatever, to move from a plane. And so far, so good, thanks to the help of many people, I arrive always even at the beginning. So that it is important, because it also delivers you a sense of dependence in the others, you know, and also a sense of humbleness. You know, you cannot move from one place to another without somebody bringing you from one place to another, which I think is a beautiful way also to understand all this work of the infrastructure, who is today so important. For me also, it has been very important that mostly railway stations are used by people who go to work every day. They go and spend maybe 5 minutes, 7 minutes, maybe 10 minutes in a station. In an airport, you spend even more. My goal has been to deliver places of dignity. Railway stations can be terrible places, but it can be also very beautiful places where children can play, where people even music can be played. And it is important that we give also through the infrastructure, first of all, the sense of the dignity to the people, and through that we restore the dignity into the infrastructure. So for example, if you look at the bridges as an example, even the railway station, until 1914, the 40s, there was wonderful infrastructure. If you go to Paris, I say that, you know, and imagine for a moment you take away all the bridges in Paris. It's another city, isn't it? It's another city. The beauty of the bridges in Paris is essential to understand the beauty of the city, not only the functionality of those bridges. If you look at its stations, you see, like Gare du Nord, like Gare de l'Est, whatever, you see, the same thing if you go to New York, you know, and you think I'm Penn Station or Grand Central. It was an enormous civic monument. And in a way, we lost this train. We lost this train. I tell you why. It's very simple. Because in the reconstruction of Europe, after the war, it was necessary to produce an enormous amount of bridges, stations, and all that in a quick period of time. And we lost the sense of the dignity of the people using those infrastructures, and also of the dignity they can have, you understand? Which we could preserve for cultural buildings like museums and other places, you understand? So it is, in my opinion, important that we reflect a little bit in this matter, because in the limits of the budget and in the limits of this capable to invest today, a public authority, it is possible through the force of the materials and the technology we have, like concrete or steel, you know, to achieve, in my opinion, a new type of infrastructural buildings. Here is the station in Liège. This is one of the most important north-south connections you see going from Berlin, Frankfurt, even Basel, up to Brussels, then to Amsterdam, then to Paris and London. And another thing, this is also a high-speed train station. And you see, this is another idea. If I go from my house to the station, it takes me 30 minutes. Once I am in the station, to go to the next city, it takes me 25 minutes. So, I mean, I have to do something like a bus shelter, you know, a big bus shelter who can incorporate a train, but it has to be very accessible, you understand? It is no more the idea of a facade, it's an open place, it's a place completely accessible from all the sides. You see the vault is a shell done in steel. These are also with a lot of passages, you see transversal and longitudinal. Here's some of the details. You see, it's just purely built in steel and concrete. The upper part, the roofs are in steel, but all the accesses down below, they are done in concrete. You can see it here, these are corridors, prefabricated elements in concrete, vaults in concrete, or bridges where the trains are passing over. We use a beautiful material, however, which it is the local stone. It's called Petit Granit, or Pierre Bleu, which it is the stone of the paving. It's a local stone, and we were privileged, you see, to do all the pavings down below with big pieces of this stone. Now, you see, also, this is another intervention, very recent. I was speaking about bridges and a station in the city of Reggio Emilia. Reggio Emilia is in the north-south axis in Italy between Milano, Bologna, Firenze. We have done, in my opinion, a major intervention, particularly in relation to the scale of the city, building three bridges. Is a transversal connection over the highway and the new railway station, very close to each other, and then they make a kind of ensemble. You see here the three bridges landmarking the very flat area. It's very, very flat. Here is an arc over the highway and also over the railroad. The two say, look at this bridge, because for me there was a kind of experimental try, you see, to do a bridge of medium span, you see, by using a transversal arc. The bridges are all done in steel. Here, the photos has been done from a great photograph. He's 93, and keep working, you know, I like that, you know, because I hope to arrive to this mark also. This is the station itself, you see. They're done all with those elements who are moving differently from these of the bodegas. Here, they are moving in two directions, isn't it, and generates a very abstract geometry. You see here some of the pictures of the interior and the exterior of the facade. Like I say, the whole thing has been done with the only resources of the steel and the concrete and using pure technical arguments, but behind it, you see, with the idea of creating something coherent and something who is fits together. This is also a bridge, is the Quarto Ponte sul Canal Grande, the fourth bridge on the Grand Canal in Venice, close to the railway station of Santa Lucia, and built after 125 years, no bridge has been built over the Canal Grande. You see here some details also. You see the handrails and the glass, the stone, also glass in the paving. Here also some details in the link from the stone to the handrail. Here the bridge is already working 8 years and has an enormous capacity. It is carrying between 17,000 to 30,000 passengers a day. This is a view in the night of the underview of the bridge. And also with a light very much, it has been very much, very well embraced by the neighbors. Here you see also a little bit of the profile, Santa Lucia, and the background of the city of Venice. This is also another pedestrian bridge, another typology. Again, you know, I want to highlight that it's very important to work in this subject because, first of all, it's a lot to do, and second, also by using technical elements. You see, like in this case here, this is a bridge in Calgary and was rather difficult to build. You can see here there is an helicopter landing place, so it was, the bridge could not be high, could be only 6 meters high, 6 meters high. Then on the other side, an enormous flood in the river is wide, and we couldn't put any support in the river. Now, how to traverse 120 meters without support, 126 by having only 6 meters high. And we introduced this idea of an helicoidal, double helicoidal structure, you see, who makes a tubular structure and then permits also to cover it, which in the winter is very convenient because lots of snow, wind and all that. And this is the idea, it's a, as I say, it's a pedestrian bridge. This is an underview of the bridge. And this is also a bridge we have built in Reggio. That is also another thing who can maybe help you to understand. When you try to do something new, you may maybe have an opportunity to do that in a smaller scale. This was Reggio nell'Emilia. This bridge done, built in Dallas is 6 times bigger, but it was fundamental to build the first step to go to that hill. This is the bridge itself with the skyline of the city in the background. Yeah. Wonderful. And now we are, you see, building a second one, who made the client dissatisfied, isn't it? Which it happens. It is a second bridge. There are two twin arcs with 360 meters span. It's under construction now. This is another subject, you see. This is the subject of the museum, and I will do some drawings for you, just that you understand that. Now, again, here it's interesting to see this project from a double point of view. The one point of view is the point of view of building something in front of a monument. Rio has been, is a rather young city, very beautiful. In my opinion, geographically, is one of the most beautiful cities you can see in the world. You see with the landscape and the light and the position of the city. And then it was also imperial city. It was there was a time in which a lot of monument was built there. One of them is called San Bento. Now, San Bento, it is a cloister which is located here, and you could see it from the bay, so the boats arriving to Rio, they will see, you know, with the landscape, famous landscape, you see, they will see the settlement, and then here was San Bento. Or is San Bento. And now, with the time, you see, the harbor and the city grow. But San Bento was so important, or it is so important, that has been classified as World Heritage Monument from the UNESCO as the first monument in whole South America. Then also other buildings grow here, like a beautiful building called Anoite. Anoite is a skyscraper. And a Praça, Praça Nova. With the time, in the 60s, they built a road, elevated. And the road cut the harbor from the rest of the city. And both, you know, went bad. The harbor was a tremendous place, and this part of the city also degenerated. Now, there is an enormous effort getting done today, you see, to recuperate the city and to even, they call it pacify, I like very much this word, pacify, pacificação da favela, a pacification of the favelas. And so, and I, believe me, I am following the works there with the modesty of my work, but they are doing an enormous social work, you see. Now, you see, there are two goals here, to do a museum in this context, and at the other side, you see, what can a museum bring beyond education, you see, what can you do as an architect? My goal, I mean, together with the people who are helping me, was let's do a museum who is shallow enough that does not disturb San Bento, so the museum will be here. And last, give him still such a prominence that it will move the heart of the people, that they remove the highway, which they are also doing. So you see, with an intervention, a local intervention, you can provoke a case through which you can move other people to react and see our city can be better. This thing is here, you know, it works, but it can work better if we do tunnels. And we turn it down. And this is what they are doing. So you see, this double wall was there since the beginning. At the other side, also, my client is not an official client. My client is called Fundação Alberto Roberto Marinho. The Fundação Roberto Marinho has been doing enormous much for education. They promote television and television programs for education in the Amazonia. And they have done books and a special thing, you know, since many, many years. And even today, they are leading a program of new museums. Museums, however, not dedicated to the past, but to the present and to the future. Like, for example, the Museum of the Football, or the Museum of the Sound, or the Museum, in our case, of Tomorrow, which is a very enigmatic thing, you know. But you see, they say this will be not a museum for answers, it will be a museum for questions. And I like that. Also, the fact of trying to do a building that just thinking in a young person, when this young person goes around, he gets already a lecture about ecology, about plants, about filtering water, about light, about sunlight, about solar energy, about the use of materials or whatever. You see, already just walking around, the museum, you get that. So let's put a little bit color and start. We started with the video, so I will speak less. Is the previous one. Rio, yes. Thank you. Okay. You see Rio as it was, and then he's San Bento. And then you, the grove of the harbor, the high skyscraper of the Noite, the Pier Mawal, and then the Plaza Mawal. This is our project. And look, the roofs, you know, it moves a little bit like an insect, isn't it? It moves, the roof can open and close. And then we have done plantation. We work with a landscape office called Burle Marx in Rio. Then there is water pools, and the water at the end is cascading into the sea after being filtered by the sandbanks in the different pools. You see here the Plaza Mawal that we ordinate, and through the ordination they decide to take away. That was not the case before. We just proposed it like that, and it's getting done. This is the entrance into the museum, very shallow museum. You see the windows open and close, they move. Then has a reception. At the one side you have a bookshop, at the other side you have a recipient center, there is an auditorium. Then there are two ramps getting up with, at the end, an observatorium of the bay, where you see the wonderful bay, and then they explain you the history, I mean, in the million of years before of the bay. And this is, then it has a sequence of elements, one after the other. This is the cafeteria down below, close to the pools, is open to everybody. And this is the cascade at the end with the bridge where people can walk also around. And here the movement of the sun. How the roofs open when the sun moves. You see the building as it was, let's say, an alive living organism moves also. And it is shallow enough that permits the view to San Bento that you are seeing here on top of the hill. In Florida, the Florida Polytechnic, and this here in Taipei. And why I say it is important, because, I mean, it is, I think, to educate people and to teach is one of the most noble things a person can do. And myself, I was a little bit out of the educational vocation. I have been always working as an architect and engineer, but I have a lot of respect for it. And to be involved in this kind of project, it, in a way, it give me the feeling I am at least giving a little bit back, you know, of this what I have again. This is a campus, the extension of an existing campus. It's a private university in Taipei, close to Taipei. There are three buildings. One is a memorial museum. The other one is a performing arts center, and the other one is the art school. And they are very, this is the Memorial Museum, part all of the art school. The basis is getting through, and it's all dedicated to the education. This is the lower part of the Memorial Museum. They are, as we are at the level minus one, but in the reality is the main level where the students are moving. This is the library, the gardens. The entrance into the Performing Arts Center and Congress Center also. It has an auditorium for music and another one for theatrics, with two parts, experimental theater and classic theater. Also exhibitions. The capacity of the hall is 1,200 persons plus chorus, who makes it, you know, a capacity of 1,400 without chorus. It's very open, daily light all around, and we introduce also a variable acoustics. It means the roof inside can begin and make the volume of the theater bigger or smaller, and pass from chamber music into symphonic. Here is a corridor for exhibition, and we are going now into the theater. Particularly this part here is very important for the visitor because it's called the Corniche, and it's really a beautiful intervention because being curved does this what happens in many beautiful cities. You are seeing the city from the city. So when you are here, you are seeing this part of the city and the skyline, when you are there, vice versa, and many of the institutional buildings are here. Then they have built here the so-called Katara, or cultural city, which it is also an important intervention and very loved by the people. And this area here is getting now developed with lower occupation, and particularly here is the core of the city. Now, you can imagine what it happens is that a lot of traffic is going here in along the Corniche, indeed. And it is completely exhausted. It's great. And not only is completely exhausted, but it is also, let's say, it started becoming from a very beautiful and pleasant place. You see, it has started to become a place where you almost want to avoid because there is so much traffic. So the local authorities, they thought, we have to do a solution, you see, to traverse the bay. How first idea will be, let's do a tunnel, but the tunnel has to have 13 kilometers. and have a connection is not good. You know, 13 kilometers tunnel is not good. You know, it's a, first of all, from the risk that you see, from the danger, from the problem that those tunnels can bring, is no more a human solution, as indeed for traffic. The second solution that we propose, it is doing a combination of bridges and tunnel, and segmenting the whole in bridges and tunnels. So, for example, here a bridge, here a bridge, here a bridge, here an island, and then the longest tunnel, 3.5 kilometers, which it means, you know, a tunnel who has a less risk. The category is a completely different liga. It's a tunnel that you can, for in 7 or 8 minutes, you are out of it, you see maybe even 5 minutes, and then it makes the whole thing more interesting, and particularly for the cityscape, the three bridges, who are, you see, also interesting it is that we do not enter, that is also an important point, I don't want to miss. Imagine, for example, that I have the shore, and I will do it, it's not necessary, this part here is very green, other are less, but let's say this is the shore, and the shore is a unique thing, because is a linear element. The shore is the conjunction of water and land, and is a line, is a line. It's not a surface, it's not a volume, it's a line. And you see, if you look in cities like New York, the conflict of those enormous bridges arriving into the city, that they have to be high, and then they impact the line of the shore, and then even in the background for almost 1 kilometer, you understand how to solve that. So we say, okay, we do also short tunnels here, and we enter in the bridge here. And we do also a short tunnel there, and we enter in the bridge, so that the shore remains untouched, number one. And second, the bridge appears like an island floating in the water, so appears like a sculpture. So finally, they got a collection of bridges floating in the water, a small island where the crossing is going, who will be all full green and became a destination, with also a people's mover to bring you into the island. So I mean, it's a way, you know, to, it's like having an enormous problem, you know, a wild horse. And then finally you get a horse to show it in a manege, you understand, to domesticate it. You see, it still is a horse, indeed, and a beautiful one. So, I mean, it's important because it delivers you a completely, I mean, I hope, a different access to the problem of infrastructure. Who is there, you know, and who in our cities, if you look all over, you know, big works, because it's very important to recreate new infrastructure, because it's also part of our time, the mobility and all of that. But at the other side, you see, it's also important to think that we can, with intelligence, you know, bring the things into a point where they have not been before, because we also have technology to do that, isn't it? Well, let's go.
Bringing also the pedestrians to the island.
This is the pedestrian bridge. The art bridge will be the biggest ever built. I mean, it's also necessary a certain capacity, a 700 meter span. This is the bridge close to the airport, also completely new. It's a shell bridge. It has to be shallow because we are very close to the airport, and the cone of approach of the airplane does not permit to be higher. And this is the bridge and the Kudrow Bay city in the background. See here also the arrival, the shore remains intact, then we need an island to jump up into the bridge. There are three different typologies, you see, so they will be also different from each other. Each one, here it's easy for us to have support, although the span are almost 300 meters. In this case, the whole length of the bridge is 1,300 meters. You see, the three bridges are, it connects, you know, like floating in the sea, and emphasizing also the landmarking capacity of the bridges and their, you see, 1, 2, 3. Wait a second. You see, we can go ahead. Just wait. You see, I used the word technology several times. We also use the word technique, technology. And we mean, yeah, that is, you know, whatever, you know, that is a pencil, it's technique, you know, something, you know, to be used every day is a good thing. Sometimes even you could say it's innocuous, you know. Everybody is happy with technique. We have words like polytechnic. Myself, I come from a polytechnic in Zurich. And even in Valencia, I study also in a polytechnic. But you see, if we go to the essence of the word technique, or polytechnic, or technology, the essence is to be found in the Greek language, in the ancient Greek language. And it is the word techniki, which means technique, techniki. Now, the word worker is tekton, again, like techniki. So a worker exercises the technique and make a job, you know, work. So from worker, tekton, comes the word technique. But the mystery is not here. That the Greeks has also another word, who is techne. And techne means art. So, between the worker, tekton, and the technique, techniki, and the art, techne, there is no difference. All the same root. We do not have that in our, at least in the Latin language. But it is like that. And what is the difference? You see, the Greeks, they say, why this man is exercising his technique, can do art, technique, they say, because it can touch me. It can touch me. I see something beautiful and it touched me. So the object is touching me, is moving me. I read a poem, you see, and I get moved, you see, and maybe I can cry, you see. There is a mystery why the words written here by this man or this object, this sculpture, this painting is moving me and is touching me. And then they say that is not a human matter. This is something mysterious. This is done by the gods. You know, the Greeks, they were very rational. So this is, and the man who has done that is not a normal man. It's not that, it's not by, because a worker using his technology is capable to do techne and move me. So there is an intervention. And they go, these are the gods who are inside this man. This man is possessed by the gods. And the word in Greek is entheos asmos. En asmos means to be possessed, and theos means God. To be possessed by God. And this is the origin of the word that we are using every day in English or even in Spanish, entusiasmo, enthusiasm. You see, what is the key of this small talk, you know, is just to tell you that there is, as I say in the beginning, you know, it's all about art. At the end, if you are conscious, all your work as an architect or as an engineer, at the end, it can have to do with the art. You understand, it's important that the young architects, they think, you know, that by making his work serious, if they really decide it and if really believe in it, they can achieve art. The work of Melnikov are pieces of art. You understand that it's important that you see it from now on. You have to see a great artist in this man. Okay, let's go. Already working 12 years in this project, this part of the reconstruction of Ground Zero, probably the most usual part. It is a transportation hub, you know. It is about railway station, about subway station, about shops and facilities where people can buy something to eat. And so, I mean, it's not something originally moving, but you know, in Ground Zero, everything became emotional. Indeed, the reconstruction of Ground Zero is an important endeavor, and we have been distinguished, you see, by having to contribute to it, and we are very proud. But indeed, it's important to see what you are seeing is just to see the functional part. It's a big space, you see, called the Oculus, where all the interior movement convey, and linking several subway stations and a highway station, and also at around flanked by facilities. But the idea is also to create a space of dignity, like you have seen this what I was telling you before. This is the subway station. Then you see, in order to avoid the greenhouse effect, the two parts, I mean, there is a gap of light, you see, and a gap of an opening all the way through. The two parts of the oculus are independent. This can be open and closed according to the days. This is the other subway station. Here down below is the railway station. We are at several levels in the underground, but one of my goals was also to make it accessible and to give the people the impression they have already arrived into the city. Next year or 1.5 years from now. Yes.
Yes.
But this is a kind of introduction. It's bringing you in a completely different world, isn't it? Has to do with all what we have seen before, but it's also the end of my talk. You know, can we go ahead? You see, I has been. It happens to you that in order to understand a project, or you go through. From the past, you see what other people have done for wonderful things. This is a mosaic in Hagia Sophia in Constantinople. And it represents, you see, this is what the Greeks call Panagia Theotokos, the mother of God, and then at the one side you have Justinian carrying the model of Hagia Sophia, and he on the other side you have Constantine. Now, first of all, for me, it has been always a mystery, you know, to get confronted to the art of the iconos, the art of the iconos. So I study carefully and discover that there is a lot, just a little bit I discover, I open just a window, there has to be a whole mystery behind it, you see, of proportions, of measures, of lines, you see, of circles and composition rules, who you may not see, but they are there. So a lot of brain power, you see, a lot of mathematical exact approach, you see, almost abstract, I think, and the suprematist and all of that, you see, the invention of the abstract, you see, or the abstraction. Even in the face of the Virgin, you see, and then they are even more circles, you know, there are a lot of them all the way around. Triangles and measures. And here you see Justinian carrying the model at the one side of the church and offering it. And at the other side, Constantine carrying the model of the city. Now, let's study for a second Panagia Theotokos. And I was fascinated, you see, from the beautiful image, the child in the center, almost inside Panagia, and then the Virgin forming, sitting in a throne. You see it. Then I started doing a series of very poor sketches, you know, I apologize, you know, because looking at the piece of art, you know, my joints, they, but it's just to help you, to help you as a path, you see, to bring you through. You see, here we have a bad copy of this what you saw before. Okay, you see, the Virgin is sitting in the throne with the child inside. Then here I took away a little bit of that, the throne, the child, the Virgin are still recognizable. Here I conserve the circle and the throne, the Virgin again. Here also, taking always the proportions of the throne, you see, and letting it also a little bit more disappear in the background, into that, and finally into the model of Constantine. It's just, as I say, you know, you astonish, you know, behind the enormous brain potential that people has maybe, I say maybe, you know, put in those things, you know, because I just discovered that, you see, it's a kind of a small experiment, you know, going step by step, but there is for sure full of enormous relations and in a way, you know, implicit in the work, you see, who enrich the work and who are there, isn't it? Then, you see, these are my poor sketches, you see, so I decided to do some sketches of Hagia Sophia with a cupola, you see, and also other cupolas, this is in Salonika, and then I discovered the Russian cupola. There's no way, no way, you know, it is really, as a, to use the apotheosis of the cupolas, isn't it? Country, you have the most sophisticated, the most transgressive, the most provocative collection of cupolas, and the idea of the cupola, you know, has never been developed, you know, so far and so magnificent and here. This is even Venice, you know, people do not know that the San Marcos is a Byzantine church. Indeed. And he also Hagia Sophia. Now, you see, I was involved in a competition for San Nicholas Church at Ground Zero. San Nicholas Church subsisted in Ground Zero 114 years until the tower came down and collapsed the church. So it was a long way until they got the permit to reconstruct a religious building at Ground Zero. And then we are now on the way to build it. It's a very tiny church. Ground Zero was once the Harvard of New York, and the Greek boats used to dock there. So it was a kind of a gathering center for new incomes and all of that, and has subsisted like that until today. And so it was a very small exercise, but still, you see here, it's all about a cupola. Here you see some views of the interior, the entry towards the altar. Here the views also of the interior. It's a very, very small church. Here you see it also looking in from the top. It has a cupola. Here a side view of the different models we have done. And it will be covered with a stone, with white stone, but translucent in the entry areas and over the cupola so that in the night it can light like a fire. Here is the location. The location is very explicit. You see here the memorial gardens, and then it's just the church is just very close to the memorial gardens up above. Here it is also in the photo montage. You see it is a very tiny scale. You see it's around the overall height of the cupola is around 20 meters. You see it here in the night. About this, what you are doing. It's also an interesting part of the profession. You see, you learn continuously. You see, so you, for me, it has been an enormous, almost an initiatic way, you know, to get confronted with the orthodoxy, to understand a little bit more about the liturgy, to try to understand in a personal way what means a cupola, you know, a dome. What means at all, in a personal way, even to investigate it, the drawings I show you, nobody tell me that. They was also just looking patiently, you see, and getting through it. The way I use is the way I try also to emphasize it, is to draw systematically. I know, you see, that the drawing has get a little bit disprestigious. But I know today they are great architects working also and doing wonderful works by drawing. You know, they cultivate the drawing. Think about, you know, to the young professionals. You see, the great painter, French painter, say, Le dessin, c'est la providence dans l'art. The drawing is the providence in the art. So the drawing has also something. It is that even if you see, if you do that with your gesture, it's yourself. So what you are seeing, bringing it into your head and putting it out, you see, from your hands, is like the wines or the grapes, you know, taking something, water from the earth and then giving us fruits, you know, outside. We have to see it like that. The capacity we have, conscient or inconscient, to transform the element we are looking at. And in my opinion, I think, you see, or I have used the drawing all my life as an instrument, you see, to of introspection in myself, but also to understanding of the reality I'm seeing. And I think maybe with that I have given you the essence. At the other side, I tell you, for those who want to exercise the profession of architect and engineer, is a profession who needs a lot of maturity. I think, you see, if you look at the work of great architects, you see they are mature works. At the end of their life, you know, Louis Kahn has done his best work, probably also in the case of Mendicoff and many others. You see, at the end of their life, they deliver the very best because it needs a great apprenticeship. You see, it needs, it's a long way to learn, you know, it's a lot what you have to learn and to understand until you are capable to do synthesis. Still, you see, don't, and I say the force of the young people like you are, you see, is the enthusiasm, the faith you have, the belief, but you have to persevere, you have to persevere. It's not a matter, it's, you see, finally it's like playing an instrument, you know. To play piano, you need to exercise. You have some great pianists, you have the great piano school, you know, here. And so, you know, look at these young people yesterday night at the Mariinsky, a 12-year-old boy, you know, perform. You know, it was unbelievable, the Saint-Saëns concert was fantastic. Then he plays also the Hungarian Rhapsody number 2 of Franz Liszt. Very difficult piece, fantastic. See, it's all about that. You understand, you see these things and you believe in, you really believe. Finally, you know, the young people are like the cars, you know, from generation to generation, they have one more speed, you know, so they go even faster, you know. So it's this kind of thing we have to see. At the one side, you need a lot of time to learn. At the other side, it's also necessary the attention and the emotion you are bringing in this moment and into your profession, you see, to succeed. What I recommend you is to be very patient, very perseverant, and knowledgeable that you, it is a hard way, isn't it? It's a tough way. You have to learn a lot. And however, you see, you have always the hope, you know. And this, I have it already, you know, to become a little bit better. Because as I say, you know, getting older, you may maybe get better, isn't it? Thank you.
Thank you very much for the talk. One more question. Do you have any, I would speak in English. Do you have any dream projects, something that you haven't designed before? And the country, where? The dream project, something you haven't designed before.
Well, you know, finally, I can tell you, you see, it's not that I specialize in that. Far apart, you know, there is, I show you, you see, but I have been involved a lot in public works, you see, so works of infrastructure, stations, museums, also now education building, concert halls. I mean, every project is interesting, you know. For me, this tiny church has been a whole world, you know, open to me. Like I say, you see, I took back, you know, the drawings I have done when I was visiting Atolf many years ago. You see, I also tried to learn as much as possible about the Orthodoxy, you see, and the liturgy, and also, as you saw, you see, I went almost in a childish way, you know, drawing cupolas, you know, all over, because I thought, you know, that it's a mystery, this idea of the cupola. It has not only a physical, but also a metaphysical importance, isn't it? And you see, it's a journey. You do a journey. So every new project is interesting, isn't it? Every new project. I think it is very important to preserve this curiosity. And the most cherished project is the last one, isn't it? It's always like that.
хорошо выступать. Dear Mr. Santiago, thank you very much for this lecture. Thank you for your deep knowing of our culture. This is really a pleasure. And I'm going to ask you a very short question. Firstly, I saw your bridge in Bilbao, so I fell in love. Then I wake up suddenly in the train station in Belgium, in the train between Paris and Cologne. So, and I move to Rio soon. So, the thing that I want to ask, could you please offer me this picture that you paint today of the... Just yes or no?
No, you know what, I promise already that to the police.
Everything, but only one, a real way.
I promise it already.
У меня к вам будет два вопроса. Один из них, как вы справляетесь с тем, когда заказчик отказывает, либо по каким-либо нормам невозможно построить то, что вы хотите. А второй, в ваших проектах в большинстве выслеживается католический храм. Интересно спросить, почему именно эти детали всплывают в проекте.
Look, you see, imagine we are building a building. We are doing something. And we go to the site and they are maybe 10, maybe 100 workers, maybe even more than 1,000 workers. So you see that evidently, you see in the site, that the site is a cooperation of many people in one direction. You see, then the same thing happens in the projects. You see, when you work in a project, you see you have also people around you. The project started maybe in your sketches, you do a lot of them. But then immediately, you know, you establish dialogue with your close collaborators, and then it's slowly, you need not only one, sometimes you need also even 10, or even 50, or even more. So many of those projects, and this is also one of the beautiful lectures of this profession, are the result of a very large collaboration. Now, what is the role of the architect in that? What is the role of the architect? Why I am the architect of my building? You see, I come back to the Greeks, and the word architect, architecton, means the first worker, or the commander of the workers. So you have to trust the people, you know. You have also to have, let's say, the capacity to communicate with them, to deliver them the enthusiasm you feel for your project and participate is very much, you see, I suppose, the work that the great conductors, you know, does. You see, like Gabriel, you see, when he has his orchestra, Marinsky Orchestra, and just with the eyes, you know, he can communicate with people and invite them, you know, to be part of this, what he has in his mind and in his heart. Finally, he's this is at the one side. At the other side, for sure, there is a little bit of composer also, you understand? Just to make a comparison with the music, you have also to work by yourself. You have to stay alone. You have to do your sketches, your drawings, where you write a partitura, you understand? See it like that. It has very much to do with music, and because it comes to my mind, you know, how can something so material, you know, like that, you hear, have to do with music, who is etheric? You say, oh, has disappeared. It's gone. You understand? So the music has no consistency, and the architecture is all consistent. Yeah? Why they have to do? I put me this question, you see, and I arrive to a conclusion. On the one side, we use almost the same words. Harmony, proportion, rhythm, are words also in architecture, as they are in music. It is because in order to experience music, you need time. the variable time. In order to experience architecture, you need also the time. So and finally you arrive to the conclusion, this is what people say, you know, that the extremities, they touch each other. You see, the extremities are not the extremities, are here behind, and they are very close together. So the examples of music are very adequate, you know, to understand how maybe the work of an architect would be.